So it takes away some time and effort when you can add technology to your office. The next thing we did was, in my campaign, I promised online records. So we have done that. I have a database of all our court records for the public, and also for attorneys can purchase a subscription to be able to see the actual documents and retrieve them if they choose to. And we have done e-filing and child support, which has cut down on our filing space, and we're very short of space in the courthouse, and we don't have a lot of room. So that cuts down on papers, which is very good and efficient. We also are e-filing civil cases. We can now e-file to the Court of Appeals any appeals that go up from our county to the Court of Appeals and to the Supreme Court. In just a couple months, we're fixing to jump off into e-filing real estate. We'll be like, I think, 11th or 12th county in the state of Georgia that's filing e-filing real estate. Also, I will be taking over the records for the state court that will be enacted July 1. I did get a beautiful filing room that the commissioners did through the reconstruction, and it is awesome. All my files are in one place. You would not believe the time it saves to be able to get in, get your file, do the job you need to do quickly and efficiently. So I'm very thankful to them for that. So those are some of the main things that we've accomplished as I took office. I'm very blessed and thankful for the opportunity to serve as the clerk. I look at it as it's important. It's our county's records, and it needs to be taken well care of, and I appreciate that. And I look forward to serving more in the future, and I just ask for your vote and your support. Thank you.
Mr. John Cass?
Skip the bus. I'm Johnny Gass, and I'm currently serving as the Chief Magistrate of Catoosa County. I've been a Magistrate Judge since 2008 and served as your Chief Magistrate Judge since 2011. Some of the things that I talked about before last election that we were going to try to implement kind of coincide with what Tracy was talking about. We've also had an e-filing system implemented in the Magistrate Court, where anybody that files any type of civil action, whether it be a civil suit or a garnishment or dispossession or what have you, they can do it online rather than having to come to the office if they desire. And also, the defendant that served one of those suits can also file a transfer online as well. One of the other things that we implemented was a e-warrant system. And this was looked at trying to help the 404 Police Department, which is on the west end of the county, kind of make things a little bit easier so they didn't have to come the distance of the county to apply for their warrants. What they can do and what we've had implemented is they can get online, they can fill out their warrant application. When the judge gets to the courthouse, we have an online session once we're notified that they're ready to go online with us. So it's a live video chat that we have. A signing pad, and it's basically just an electronic warrant. And that's really worked out well. And I hope in the future try to do something along that lines with the county if that may be needed in the future as well. I've been a resident of Catoosa County for all my life, 48 years, and my whole career has been in serving the citizens of Catoosa County, 29 years of it, right after high school. So I enjoy serving the citizens of Catoosa County, and I hope to continue my tenure as Chief Magistrate Judge. Some of the things that the Magistrate Court does, if those of you that aren't familiar with it, several of them mentioned that we have different types of hearings that we have to preside over. First appearance hearings, that's somebody's first appearance before a judge once they're arrested, and that's usually done via video chat from the jail, from the Catoosa County Jail. And we also have preliminary hearings and truancy hearings, civil cases, civil suits, $15,000 below. Dispossessor hearings where people were evicted from their homes or their properties for not paying what they should be paying to their landlord. There's several other that I can mention, but we're a very busy office and we've got a great staff. My staff is just as dedicated as I am to be sure that the citizens receive what they need to receive in a timely manner. I hope to continue to serve as your chief magistrate. I really enjoy my job. Like I said, I've been serving the citizens all my career, and that's about all I know to do, and I hope to continue that. Thank you.
Staying with the G's, we move to Keith Green.
How's everyone this evening? Doing well, I hope. For those who don't know me, I'm Keith Green. I'm the chairman of the Board of Commissioners. I was born in Brunswick, Georgia, and I'm a graduate of Brunswick High School. I'm not a Yankee, but I'm actually a Boston Red Sox fan. After graduating from high school, I joined the Army and was sent to Fort Benning, Georgia. At the age of 31, I was accepted to the University of Notre Dame and eventually graduated in 1998 and in 2000 with Bachelor and Master Science degrees in Electrical Engineering. In January of 2003, I was sent to Fort Stewart to prepare for Operation Iraqi Freedom. In March 2003, my unit deployed overseas and we returned home 1 year later. In August 2008, I retired as a military officer after serving our country for 25 years. I'm currently the new product introduction quality manager at Roper Corporation located in Lafayette. I'm a certified Lean Six Sigma Master Black Belt. Since I was elected in 2008, Catoosa County has endured one of the worst economic recessions in modern times and one of the worst natural disasters in county history. Even with these overwhelming obstacles, we haven't lost any ground, and in fact, we've continued moving forward to prepare our county for the future. Overcoming a recession and an EF5 tornado would have financially crippled most counties. However, through prudent financial management and the establishment of fund balance reserves, we were able to self-fund our own recovery effort, endure economic hard times, and later successfully document the county's natural disaster claims to receive maximum reimbursement for FEMA, GMA for natural or for disaster recovery efforts. In 2009, our annual county tax sales tax revenue was $5.5 million. In 2015, our annual county sales tax revenue improved to $7.9 million. These improvements in sales tax revenue are directly attributable to our economic development efforts to attract quality retail establishments such as Costco, Cabela's, and other major retail developments. These successes were achieved through innovative and forward-thinking public-private economic development partnerships.
Crony capitalists.
Executed through our Catoosa County Economic Development Authority. In addition to retail growth, we have experienced and are continuing to experience growth in an industrial segment as well. Shaw Industries has invested well over $80 million in facility upgrades in their three Ringgold locations to produce luxury vinyl tile, to continue its growth of laminate flooring business, and to implement an innovative, environmentally friendly technology to recycle carpet and flooring waste in usable products. The retail industrial successes have led to increased employment opportunities as well as increased tax revenues, and we expect growth in these areas in the future. However, expansion is currently limited to some degree by the lack of adequately trained workforce. To address this need, we have partnered with Georgia Northwestern Technical College to locate a state-of-the-art campus in Catoosa County on Highway 151, and students should begin being served at this location by summer of 2016. Since 2009, the county has continued to upgrade and expand its infrastructure to improve stormwater facilities and to install or upgrade several miles of sewer line through partnership with each city. In addition, prior to 2009, our public works department averaged paving 6 miles of road per year. Our current average is 12. Our county now has an improved process and procedure for conducting an inventory inspection of county roads to set priorities for resurfacing and repairs. We have been able to maximize eligibility for and use of available federal and state funds for road projects. 2016 proposed roads were resurfacing improvements are Bandy Lane, Lakeview Drive, Wooten Road, portions of Stewart Road, and Pine Grove Road. In addition, improvements have been made in the area of emergency operations by coordinating resources and establishing priorities for road clearing during winter emergency operations. In 2016, our judicial system will have a state court for further improved courthouse efficiencies. The state court will assist in reducing our current inmate population at the jail and thereby reduce jail operating costs and the need for jail expansion. It will also expedite both civil and criminal case filings through the court system. These efficiencies and cost savings are expected to be realized without negative impact on the county budget. For the past 7 years, I've provided leadership to the county during extremely difficult times, and along with my fellow commissioners, I have helped save and prepare the county to experience the best of times looking forward. The hard work and efforts I've put forth helped make Catoosa County a better place to live, work, be educated, and raise a family, and have resulted in expected substantial future growth in the county. In anticipation of the future growth, we have overhauled and improved land development ordinances so future growth is properly managed. We continue to improve county infrastructure, employment, education opportunities, and quality of life. So anyway, I'd like to thank you all for this opportunity to serve you as Catoosa County Chairman. I look forward to the next 4 years, and I would appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Mr. Hullender.
Thank you, Denise. Perhaps it's quite a bit larger crowd than the last time that we were in a public meeting, but it's been crazy 15, 16 months. As you know, I'm completing the expired term of Judge Lowry, and so we're having to run again. We're trying to get on cycle with everybody now. And it's been an amazing 15, 16 months. I don't want to say this in front of Commissioner Greene, but I can't believe I get paid for what I'm doing. I mean, it's amazing. It really is. I love it so much. I'm a people person, and the probate court is kind of an open court. You can walk right in. You can talk to the judge. If you don't know what probate does, we handle everything from estates to guardianships to weapons carry permits. That's huge right now. Correct, Sheriff?
Correct.
A lot of fingerprinting. Marriage license, obviously that was huge back in June of this past year. And we've been very blessed to stay on course. There's a lot of things that we've implemented since the time we've started as a probate judge. We're online now with people can pay for their marriage license and their carry permits with debit cards. We've never had that. We've implemented a teen driving school. And what that is, it's a teen victim impact program is what it is. And all of the underage drivers are 20-year-old drivers and under that commit a moving violation. They have to go to a class. This is a nonprofit organization. They go to a class. They talk about driving while texting, driving while under the influence, distracted driving. They cover everything. They have some very intense videos that they watch, and it's a very good program. I require all of my underage drivers to go to that as part of their sentence, and it's been very effective so far. We implemented that first of this year. We had our first class in January. We had our second one. Our first class, we had 36 people. We had 66 people last Wednesday, so it's been very good. The Judge Blevins down in Whitfield County, we worked with her. She uses the class, Judge Stoltz and Ringgold, and then some of the other surrounding judges use that class. One of the other things that we've implemented while we're there, working with my solicitor, Sean Bob, is a pretrial diversion. I know that Magistrate Court got a pretrial diversion. And we have a weigh station in our county, and we have a lot of motor carrier citations go through our county. And what we do is if you ever look at the law book and pertaining to motor carrier citations, it's pretty intense. It's pretty extensive too. And so we want to give somebody that uses their their license and their driving privilege as a CDL driver as their income. We want to allow them to be able to pay for what they've done, you know, and through this pretrial diversion. And what it is basically a 90-day program. We looked at the statute on it, make sure that we were doing it properly, as we do everything. And 90 days, if the driver, if the offender gets no more citations, they pay an administration fee, have to write a paragraph or two, a page, why they did what they did and how they're going to correct it. And basically, that's pretrial diversion. And so that's worked very well. We're very proud of our staff. We have five ladies that work very hard. I don't worry about my staff. See, I took office. I was elected on November the 4th. November the 10th, I took office because it was time to have a new probate judge. And if it wasn't for my staff, their knowledge, I have three paralegals on my staff. I have a lady that's been in traffic for 22 years that knows the ins and outs of traffic, and they're fantastic. And I give them all the credit for what they kind of guided me through this process. I kid everybody, they do all the hard work. All I have to do is sign the paperwork. So, and I really appreciate them. And I appreciate the voters of this county, and I appreciate the citizens. And there was a term that was said a few weeks back is that to be a good and effective county, you have to follow the money. You ever heard that? You don't follow the money, you follow the citizens, okay? You take care of the citizens first and everything else will fall into place, okay? Thank you and I appreciate your vote.
Sheriff Sisk.
Always bringing up the rear. I am Sheriff Sisk. I have served the citizens of Catoosa County for 3+ years as your sheriff. And I'll tell you, it has been my honor and my pleasure to do so. Of course, I served in the sheriff's office 20+ years prior to this. And so I kind of knew what I was getting into. But I tell you, it's truly been a blessing for me to serve the citizens of Catoosa County. I ran on a platform of rehabilitation, and we kind of took a two-pronged approach to this. First was, yes, rehabilitation with our inmates. We have issues with recidivism. You know, still over 50% of the population in jail is recidivist, probation violations. So with that, we started a lot of programs in the jail. We partnered with Georgia Northwestern. We offer a GED program, in which I am happy to say last month we did have a graduate from that program. So we are making progress one life at a time. We do Narcotics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous, Parenting Wiser classes, anger management classes, trying to make these people better people so that they don't come back. Also, what we've done though on our second prong of that approach was we looked at our young people and we decided to make bigger investments on our young people. So first, we were one of the first sheriff's offices in Georgia to start teaching CHAMPS in middle school. We partner with a number of our local children's programs, the Teen Maze, which teaches our teens about alcohol and drugs. One of our big accomplishments that I really like is we partnered with Partnership 2000. If you don't know what that is, that's a business partnership with the school system where you citizens or business owners or employees in the county can actually pair up with them and go in and mentor to children in our school system. Well, I actually got my employees interested in that, and we go out and we mentor to elementary age students. And we're in about 8 of our elementary schools. The counselors pick the children. They're typically at-risk children. Some of them we have more than one. Some of them we have multiple children that we mentor. But you go play a board game, play cards with them, throw a ball, eat lunch with them, just spend some time with that young person. And to me, that's trying to break that cycle of crime. You know, we've seen with the amount of time I've been in law enforcement in Catoosa County, we've had multiple generations come through our system. Multiple generations, we're still dealing with. There was a young man in our jail just last year that we've been dealing with his family my entire career in law enforcement. When we were first going over to their house, that young man was running around in a diaper. And now he's spent most of his adult life in prison. And I talked to him about that. He said, look, when I'm there, when I'm out, I've got to act a certain way. That young man never had a chance. So something what we're working on with that is involving a lot of our community faith-based organizations, getting them involved with mentorships, getting them, just telling, asking them to get involved with young people around their churches and start making a difference in their lives and start making an influence. Some of the programs that we've started, our first one was we started a Facebook page at the Sheriff's Office. That has been a great success. We've helped solve a number of cases for not just the Sheriff's Office, but our local police departments and other surrounding agencies. You know, with that, I like to tell this fact that we put an individual on there trying to get them identified, and the shortest amount of time it took to get them identified was 6 minutes. And that's nothing that we could have done if they're beating the street. It taken, you know, just to drive to the area and start doing some door-to-door to get somebody identified. And we have people sharing information with us like that. And that's what it takes. It takes the community getting involved. And that's what I've tried to do as your sheriff, is be a community-oriented sheriff, to really get the community involved. It's going to take all of us to make a difference. Unfortunately, our society and where we're headed is not a good place. It is a dark place. And if everybody doesn't start getting involved and starting to try to make it head in the right direction, I'm fearful of where we're going. But I tell you, I was just at a luncheon this week with Rising Professionals and seeing our teenagers involved in our schools, and I got to sit down and talk with a table full of them. And I tell you, I feel energized about it. I think we've got some good generations coming up, but it's going to take all of this community, though, to support them and make sure they get where they're going. So I'd love to serve another term as sheriff of Catoosa County, and I greatly appreciate your support and vote. Thank you.
Denise had to step out. We also have one challenger who wasn't at our earlier meeting last month. So we'd like for Stephen Henry to come up.
I thought it would be good to go last, and y'all were good. Thank you about voting for me. I thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. All of y'all have done a great job. We were with that event with Gary the other day with the Rising Professionals. It's a great program. I think we live in a great county. I love this county. Johnny's got me by 4 years. I've only been here 44 years. You got 48. But I think we live in a good county. I would love to see some more positive growth in our county. I'd love to see unity between our cities. It's almost like a lot of times our city of Fort Oglethorpe and Catoosa County are separate entities, but we try to butt heads. I'd love to see a relationship where we can grow together, where the cities would all three work together, we could gain some more industries, some more businesses, different places. My speech is not going to be as long as these people, so I can just tell you, I prepare one that's nice and appropriate. But, just want to say I appreciate your vote, and love to have the opportunity to serve this county. I've made a good living in this county. Lived here, worked here, raised my son here, graduated here. I'd love the opportunity to serve as your county commissioner. Thank you.
Public Service Commission. Even though it's a District 2, it is a statewide election on May 24, 2016. I'm a Houston County resident, a former military spouse of 16 years. I have a son, Ian, who's 11 years old, and a daughter, Yvonne, who's 6 years old. I'm also a member of Houston County GOP and also treasurer of the Ringgold Republican Women. This evening, I wanted to give a brief intimate conversation about who I am, because most of you do not know me. So I was actually born in New Orleans, Louisiana, and raised in Marrero, Louisiana, to a very impoverished family. We had drug and alcohol abuse and very low education. And I was a child who was very inquisitive about my community. It was my middle school band teacher who took me to Oakwood Mall on my birthday. We sat outside eating German chocolate cake, watching over 70 people fly kites. And he said to me, "Michelle, you can fly high as a kite as long as you have passion for what you're doing. And all the tools you need to be successful is already inside of you." This was a message that I have never heard in my life, and it literally sent me on a path of success. I felt as though he handed me the keys to my liberty. And what did I do with those keys? Well, I was a classically trained opera singer from middle school to college. I learned how to play three different instruments, trombone, tuba, and baritone. By the age of 15, I was on a TV show called Our Generation with Sally Ann Roberts on Channel 4 News. I was a student reporter. By the age of 15 also, I was an FBI witness against Jefferson Parish Police Department at that time in New Orleans, Louisiana. The police were killing witnesses, and I had to testify against 8 of them. And even though it could have cost me my life, I knew I had to start off doing the right thing, otherwise I wouldn't end up doing the right thing. By the age of 16, I represented the state of Louisiana in the National Bicentennial Competition. My first airplane ride was to Washington, D.C., where I debated members of Congress and a Supreme Court justice on the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. There were so many people who invested in me in my life. And they were strangers who became my friends and my mentors and now my family. And so I'm running for Public Service Commission, and I have education and experience for it. One, I am a Penn State graduate in energy and sustainability policy. I did my study abroad in Costa Rica on a scholarship with Penn State to study geothermal, solar, wind, biomass, biofuel. I'm also certified as an ArcGIS, or in ArcGIS, which is transmission line siting, route optimization, metadata analysis. I'm also certified as an ethical leader in business and policy from the NASPA Center for the Public Trust. So what is the Public Service Commission? We regulate electric, natural gas, and telecommunications, but I'm here to tell you that we can do so much more. If all of you can do me a favor, if you can raise one hand in the air, come on, you can do it. And repeat after me, can you say, "I am a shareholder"?
I am a shareholder.
Oh, come on, I know you have more Republican spirit than that. Can you say, "I am a shareholder"?
I am a shareholder.
Thank you. The reason why I brought you through this exercise is so that you can know that every time you pay your taxes, every time that you pay your electric bill, you are investing in the state of Georgia, you are investing in the Public Service Commission, and that means you are a shareholder. And we are responsible for you. We should be your financial steward and investor, which means we need to watch over your money, right? We need to make sure that you have a positive return. We need to be your advocate, which means before we make a rate case decision, we need to call your public officials to see how they're doing. They don't do that today. We need to make sure that we share information with your community, because energy is more dynamic than what you pay for it and how you can consume it. Energy can actually be a tax saver. It can be a job creator, and it can be a money saver in your community, and I will let your officials know that information. Finally, we can be an educator. We need to teach each and every one of you how you can maximize the amount of energy that you use in a month. You know, it's not okay that we all live on a budget, right? It's not okay that our rates are going up and up and we're not doing anything about it. But I will. My name is Michelle Miller. I'm running for District 2 Commissioner of the Georgia Public Service Commission. I have cards outside if you want to sign up for my campaign. I really want to earn your support and your vote. Thank you very much.
everyone. Keep in mind that the primary election is on May 24th, so tell your friends and neighbors and get them out there to vote. So we also had, were all incumbents, did everybody get the chance to speak? Did we miss anybody? Okay. Or anyone, any candidates that were at the, that were not at the prior meeting? All right. Denise also had wanted us to recognize those who had qualified today. We have Mike Key, Jama House, and Charles Stevens for Tax Commissioner, Gary Sisk and Ben Scott for Sheriff, Jim Cutler, Commissioner, and Stephen Henry for Commissioner at Large. Did I miss anybody?
You missed one.
Sorry. I don't have the list here. She is the one there qualifying, so Tracy did. Jeff too. Okay, right. Yeah, she did say there were 10. And Gary. Did I not say Gary? Gary Aubrey. So next, I wanted to recognize Nydia Tisdale, who is here videoing. Maybe if you come up here for a moment and just say a little bit about what you do in the campus. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I am a citizen journalist. I am video recording tonight's meeting, and it will be available on YouTube, on my YouTube channel. Videos are viewer supported, and gifts are greatly appreciated. I also bring gifts from the State Attorney General's Office, which is the Red Book, A Citizen's Guide to Open Government, which is Georgia's Sunshine Law. So those are the Open Meetings Act and the Open Records Act. They are free. They're at the back of the room. Please help yourself on your way out. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we're really glad to get to this portion of the evening with our featured speaker, Dale Jackson. Dale is the husband of Sarah, dad to Camille, Colin, and Gavin. He's a business owner of Jackson Heating and Air, and the third largest, which is the third largest train supplier in Georgia. Dale is the chairman of the 3rd District Republican Party. His 8-year-old son, Colin, is autistic, and based on research and the advice of medical professionals, they explore treating Colin with cannabis oil. Dale has been very active recently in speaking out about the fact that in Georgia, cultivation is not allowed at the moment. So he is going to share some of that information with us and his journey and fight for that. So welcome him, please.
I do appreciate y'all affording me the opportunity to come and speak tonight. I would love to spend the last half of it just answering questions, because I don't get the opportunity to speak that often in front of people that may disagree with me. And one thing that I've learned over the last couple of years is this can be controversial. I want to keep it away from being personal. Now, obviously, it's pretty personal for me, and it is sometimes difficult to keep the emotions out of it. But we're trying to take a very scientific approach, a very limited government, liberty approach. I do have a couple of questions I want to start with. You don't have to raise your hand if you know, or you can speak out. I don't really care. House Bill 1 last year. Is anybody familiar with House Bill 1? You might know what it does, what it did. Well, it legalized medical cannabis oil. Anybody know what medical cannabis oil is? Well, but here's my question. Medical cannabis oil is legal in the state of Georgia. But I have a pop quiz for you. Does anybody in this room know where I or anyone registered with the state of Georgia can go to purchase medical cannabis oil?
Colorado.
That is a great guess, and you are 100% wrong.
No.
There is not one single state in our union that I or any other resident of Georgia who has registered with the state, who has gotten a written document from their doctor, who has been approved for medical cannabis oil. There is not one single U.S. territory that we can go to purchase medical cannabis oil. Now, I can go to Colorado and buy a bag of weed, but I may, just may, be the only person in this battle advocating for medical cannabis oil who has actually never even seen marijuana before. So I wouldn't know where to start in Colorado buying a bag of weed, but I bet it's probably a lot easier there than here. Well, probably not, because it probably can be purchased within a half a mile from here. Matter of fact, statistics say that it can be purchased within a half a mile from here. But is that safe? Is that the best Georgia can do? Is pass a law giving our residents the ability to treat their child, but not give them an avenue to purchase it? Or, better, even worse, to say, well, you can purchase it. Please, just go to another state. Purchase it illegally. Leave that state. Break that state's law. Break federal law. And then come back here. Now, we don't want you to have it tested in a lab to determine if there's any imperfections in the oil for your child. We want you to fly out to Colorado like my best friend did just yesterday and buy a bag of weed, set up a lab in his hotel room, and make cannabis oil. A parent has to make medicine. That's the best Georgia can do. Now, I say that pretty sarcastically, as you may guess. Are there any fans of Obamacare in here? Any? I'll give you a minute to think about it. No fans of Obamacare? Now, wasn't the number one thing that the Republican Party, conservatives of America, the number one complaint about Obamacare? Why do I need government getting in between me and my doctor? I ask you, is this any different? If I have a doctor that tells me he's seen evidence of cannabis oil treating children with seizures, those with MS, those with autism, do we not have a right to try? Earlier it was mentioned a little bit about my family. I can't remember if it was mentioned or not, but just to add a little bit of irony to the situation, I'm really good friends with my sheriff. And my brother-in-law happens to be the head drug agent in Troop County. Now that makes for some interesting dinner conversation. But he's actually on board. But that leads to another part of my discussion tonight. And there's a clock here, so I won't go too long. Yes. My son, Colin. Now many of you maybe know someone. Chances are, statistics say you do know someone that has autism. I doubt very seriously that you know the real world of autism. It's many times not very pretty. Now, we all see in the stories that they post on Facebook how the autistic child, because of X, Y, and Z therapy, just miraculously got better. I've seen those. You know how often I get sent a video from an autistic child that has cannabis oil that all of a sudden began to speak? Every single day. Do you know how bad that hurts a father that's poured 2 years of his life into fighting for a possible option? Do you know how long my wife and I have longed to hear my child say a word? My son is 7 right now. He'll be 8 in just a couple of weeks. Be honest with you. Typically, birthdays aren't very happy occasions. It's always cute. A little one-year-old that digs into that cake, it's all messy. I'm still waiting on my son to dig into that cake and get messy. It really made me happy. Scientific studies show that after the age of 7, the amount of advancements that an autistic child can make dramatically dwindle. Did I mention that my child is 7? He'll be 8 in a couple of weeks. All the while, we have politicians acting as doctors at the Capitol that are telling me, well, Bill, you know, laws just take time. Laws take time. So before I get into just exactly that process, I want to slow down for a minute. Because chances are you are like a large majority of the entire state. And sometimes we forget, because I have been neck deep in this for over 2 years. And sometimes a lot of people just don't understand what exactly House Bill 1 was and what exactly House Bill 722 is and why it's important. For starters, now, as I'm sure that our law enforcement officers have pointed out, that it is possible under some scenario for you to get high off of cannabis oil. So I'm not going to try to say that it is impossible. Now, it's important to understand cannabis oil, which could technically be at any strength possible, is a little bit different than the law that was passed in Georgia. House Bill 1 has, you know, certain guidelines, restrictions. So you can only have up to 5% THC. And it has to be at a 1-to-1 ratio. So it also has to contain 5% of CBD. So CBD is a completely innocent and completely legal in all 50 states. CBD, that is an oil that comes from the marijuana plant or a hemp plant, is completely legal. You can generally, I guarantee there's a place here in town that you can go and purchase CBD oil that contains zero THC. THC is obviously what everybody's worried about. But in House Bill 1, the law states that it can be up to 5% THC, but it has to be at a 1-to-1 ratio. And what does that mean? Why is that important? Well, if you have 5% CBD oil, or just CBD, it's a really long word that I don't even really know how to pronounce that well. Cannabidiol oils. But it's not oil. Don't get me started. And then you have THC. They cancel each other out as far as getting high. So you can take, under current law, There's absolutely no way that you could get high as long as you had up to 5% THC and 5% CBD. The CBD actually cancels out the euphoric feeling that you would get with the cannabis oil. Now, and then it covers a variety of patients. I don't know them all. Half of them I cannot pronounce. It's all in my truck. But there are some seizures, and very rare seizures. Cancer, as long as you were literally about to die, you can take cannabis oil under Georgia law. Now, with House Bill 722, we attempted to remove some of those restrictions, because what we found, just like when we tried to pass this law originally in 2014 and it didn't pass, by the time 2015 came around, we had learned a lot more. Well, now we've learned even more. And now we've learned of all sorts of different conditions, and what do they need? A lot of them, and autism would be one of those, requires a very high percentage of THC. So that was some of the things we tried to get added into the bill. Now, do y'all remember that first question I asked you? Where can a resident of Georgia go and legally purchase cannabis oil? Well, 85% of House Bill 722 was giving the state the legal option to do what? To grow. Now, what does that mean? Because that's going to mean something different to probably each and every one of you in this room. Now, most people, when they hear that, they think, doggone, I'm going to get to grow a pot of weed. Well, if you've got a lot of land, you've got roughly about $15 million to invest. If you can fill out the 28-page requirement, if you can provide a security system that probably costs about $500,000 that's directly connected back to the sheriff department, if your sheriff in your county approves of you growing after you're certified and awarded one of the 6 licenses in the entire state, then yes, you will be able to grow some weed. The chances are that's not many of you in this room. And it's certainly not going to happen in anybody's backyard. But that's what we were asking for. We were asking for a legal right to provide medicine for our child that the governor signed into law that said we could. Instead, you know what we got? This year, when he took about 50 pages of House Bill 722 and ripped out every word in it that had anything to do with growing, and you know what he replaced it with? You know, if I wasn't about to tell you the truth, this would be funny. He gave immunity. The governor of Georgia gave immunity to a manufacturer in Colorado. This is a Republican Party, right? Mm-hmm. We do understand constitutional law, right? Mm-hmm. Strike that. We understand basic common sense, right? Can the governor of Georgia provide immunity for anybody in the state of Colorado? Especially when it comes to breaking federal law. I guarantee you that manufacturer does not give a hoot who Governor Neal is. He's concerned about President Obama and the Department of Justice. But thankfully, our governor ripped out cultivation and gave a citizen, a corporation in Colorado immunity. If we were doing our job correctly, they would be too embarrassed to put that in the law. That's a shame. And I guarantee you that maybe, because the Speaker of the House actually sent it out an amendment and was championing the idea and encouraged all 180 state representatives to put that in your newsletter back to your constituents at home, Let them know that we provided immunity for parents of Georgia in Colorado. You can say what you want to about cannabis oil. You can say that it may lead to something else. But folks, if that's the best we can do in Georgia, if that's the best a state that is almost unanimously controlled by Republicans, if that's the best we can do, amen. Why do y'all think that is? Why do you think the number one answer that you would give when you go to the Capitol? Well, you know, laws are complicated. Laws take time to pass. Why is that? Do y'all have any idea how much money lobbyists are putting into politicians' campaigns just because they want to convince them to vote no against House Bill 722? Oh, but wait. Almost that same amount of money is getting put in those same campaigns to try to convince them to vote yes. So don't you think it would be in that politician's best interest? Let's just drag this out a couple of years. Why in the world would that politician want to vote no and pass a bill and be productive when he can continue to get $10,000 this year from this lobbyist and $10,000 from this lobbyist on both ends of the spectrum? Started out talking about THC. Well, as I mentioned, we're learning. Every day, there's new strains coming out. New strains of the plant, and then new strains that come out of the plant. Do y'all know that there's a particular strain called THCA? Now, as far as the law is concerned, THCA is the exact same thing as THC. There's two things, though, that are important about THCA. One, my son needs THCA, so it's pretty doggone important to me. Do you know what the second important thing about THCA is? Besides the fact that it is completely illegal, you could drink a Mountain Dew bottle full of it and not get high. It does not react in your body anywhere close to the way THC does. But according to law, it's the same thing. So there are those that are battling at the Capitol against a strain that does come from apparently an evil plant God created a long time ago, because I know you heard that before, that cannot get you high. You can take it and you won't, it'll be the exact same thing as, anybody got high off Advil before? I mean, Tylenol can kill you if you take too much Tylenol. Who would abuse a drug, a medicine that doesn't get you high? It provides no reason to abuse it. I don't know, I'm still asking the same question. I haven't got a good answer yet, but I guess there's somebody out there that would. So, many people know a little bit about my story on Facebook. Apparently, I tend to post a lot. But my son is on cannabis oil. right now. He started on Thursday, had his first dose. My son is not on the state registry. He is not, he did not, we did not get a doctor approval. But I'm here to tell you why that is 100% legal for me and my son. And that was a loophole that our good friends over at the GBI found. Apparently they found it last summer and decided not to tell anybody. I really would have appreciated that they told me. But in our hearing on February the 22nd, when it came time to actually pass the bill out of committee, they knew that finally, that was the day it was going to pass. So they had to bring up the language of the bill. And so, in as simplest terms as I possibly can, because I promise you I've been studying this for 10 days and it is still extremely complicated. So don't feel bad if you have questions at the end. I still have questions. According to Georgia Code, cannabis oil, keep in mind now, we're not talking about a plant. We're only talking about extracts from the plant, just in oil form. Technically, they call it a sample. If it contains less than 15%, then the Georgia Law Code doesn't acknowledge it that it even exists. There is no law against having cannabis oil that is less than 15% THC. To keep in mind, I need THCA. I can't even get you high for that. We've already went over it. We'll do it again. Now, unfortunately, we actually passed House Bill 1 last year. So this is where it kind of gets a little weird. So from 14.9% THC cannabis oil, that's perfectly legal. All the way down until you get to 5%. Now all of a sudden is no longer legal for anybody to have. Because we passed House Bill 1. So that's a law. And House Bill 1 states that if you're going to have cannabis oil, if it's going to contain THC up to 5%, then these are the steps you have to go through to be approved to have it. And these are the restrictions and the guidelines that you have to have. So that's pretty big news. Now I'm totally shocked that everybody's not trying to get this word out there. But the truth is that it is 100% legal. Now they're going to completely close that loophole if they pass House Bill 722. And the governor has already told us that even if we don't pass House Bill 722, even though it's worthless at this point, then he's going to take that language that closes that loophole and he's going to put it into another bill at the very last minute. And our governor's proven he can do anything he wants. So until we no longer accept that as a state, then that's the way it's going to be. So that's the loophole. It's just on the radio today in Atlanta discussing that. So anybody that you know, let them know that it is 100% legal for any condition whatsoever. Now you still can't buy it, but it's legal. And so why is it important that we let everybody know that? And why has everyone fought against House Bill 1 last year and House Bill 722 this year? If everybody that could potentially benefit from cannabis oil took advantage of this loophole that's going to be open for the next probably 2 to 3 months and saw the benefits of cannabis oil, they would begin to change their mind. My family, I mean, we're good old Southern Baptists. At least we used to be. We're still good old, we're just not Baptists anymore, sorry. you know, they completely changed their opinion about marijuana. And that's just human nature. That's who we are. We've been told for 40 years that marijuana is an evil plant, that marijuana is addictive, that you'll die if you don't just say no, according to Barbara Bush. Anybody want to raise their hand and say, and let me know how many people have ever died from marijuana? Marijuana overdose? We're still waiting. Not for you to answer, we're still waiting on the first one. Do y'all want to know the number one cause of death in this country? Accident related? So like not heart disease or cancer. Accidental overdose from FDA approved prescription drugs. That is the number one killer in our country for accidents. Accidental overdose of government approved, pharmacy created drugs. Most of them contain cocaine. In the eyes of the law, cocaine is better than marijuana. I won't go there anymore. So, I know I'm gonna have to close pretty soon. I'm not gonna get it done. Because I'm gonna bottle of water and I'm about to die. But cultivation, why is it important? I'm just one person. And granted, a lot of people comment and stuff on my Facebook page, but every single day, at least since my son started taking cannabis oil, somebody has contacted me. And they said, you know, I had no idea that cannabis oil could possibly benefit my son with autism. And that's why we're fighting. Because I don't know every single person in the state. Apparently, Facebook's maxes out at 5,000 friends. So, without cultivation, without giving parents a realistic way to get this medicine, there are hundreds of thousands of potential patients that will never get help. And that's why we continue this. Because last year, autism, my son was one of the first things that the governor cut out of the bill. And I continue to fight. This year, for right now, autism is still in the bill. But cultivation was gutted out. And we do not support this bill. Because without cultivation, all we're doing is we're giving the governor and all of the legislators that don't have the courage to stand on their own two feet and vote the way they think they should vote and vote with the 80% of Georgians that believe we should have cultivation. And I'm going to fight against House Bill 722. Do y'all have any idea how long and how many tears and drops of blood I have sweat into this bill? And now that my son is finally added into this bill, I'm going to be forced to vote or encourage others to vote against it. That is extremely painful for me as a father. But I refuse to allow our governor to get one more ceremonious bill through that he can say he's helping the kids. He's not helping anybody. Nearly all the parents that are participating in House Bill 1 doesn't cover them. I mean, we're already felons. We're already breaking federal law. We're already breaking Colorado law or Washington law or Oregon law. It's time to actually help the parents. If you don't want to, that's fine. You know, if you think it's just a bad idea, I'm okay with that. If your legislator thinks it's just a bad idea, it could lead to some bad place. That's okay. I don't have a problem with a legislator voting no. Matter of fact, generally 98% of the time, I respect a no vote a lot more than a yes vote. But have the courage to stand up and vote no. Instead of secretly behind closed doors ripping out every single thing in the bill that matters to the parents and to the patients. Now, I want to leave you with one last thought. Over the past year, I've met countless parents. And as I mentioned before, I get contacted every day with other autistic parents around the world wanting information or telling me the story of their child. I started out telling you about the ugly side of autism, the side that you generally don't see very often. And that's the story of a little 3-year-old girl right up the street from my house, whose parents had to strap to the bed and had to put pads on her arms because she was literally chewing her arm off. That's the story of a 15-year-old boy that went to bed completely normal and woke up the next day and started beating his head against the wall. They did studies and they said that the amount of stress that an autistic parent deals with on a daily basis is equal to a combat veteran when it comes to the flashbacks, the terror, and fear, a constant fear. Let me tell you what I go to sleep every night to. You know what that is? That's my sweet, gentle 7-year-old child tapping his head against the wall. He's just tapping. Every night, I go to bed with the fear that when I wake up, that's what I'm going to be woken up to. You can't understand that. That's okay. I don't want you to understand it. It's okay that you don't understand it. Be grateful you don't understand it. But give me the opportunity to care for my child. That's all I've got.
Well, I hope everyone found that informative as I would. And I have, if you're like me, I wasn't aware that the substance that has been approved to be legal for medical use cannot be obtained legally in Georgia. So thank you, Dale, for highlighting that. And thank you to everyone who's come here today, for the candidates who spoke. And I hope that you'll be back to our next meeting. We probably won't be here. We'll be at the Hampton Inn again, but the first Monday of every month. If you are not on our email list, make sure that you sign up outside there. We have a list. And, you know, stay and ask questions of the candidates and of Dale after the meeting. So thank you very much. And adjourn now.